So first, I have to apologize that I don't speak Polish. I can swear fluently in Polish because my grandmother was Polish, my father was born in Poland, and when my grandmother would get angry, she would revert to Polish. So if you make me angry, you might hear me. And it's a pleasure to be here. It's a special city. It's not my first time, and it means something for me to come back. And I think the title you read was A Non-Instrumental Approach to Law. And I want to explain what I mean like that. Typically, even without thinking, we have an instrumental approach to law. Because the law is the servant of policy. It can be environmental policy or it can be criminal justice. So we have some social, political objective for which we need law. Because we decide that we will rely on law with its coercive power to achieve the policy goal. And then we write a law, and what we do, we interpret it, we argue about the interpretation. If we do contextual law like here, we might ask what is the economic context, what is the social context of that law to try and understand it better. We might do an impact study to see, you know, does the death penalty really reduce the number of murderers, or does the environmental measure actually clean the air, etc. But the core of our activity, even if we're not just positivists, has an instrumental approach to law. Law is an instrument to achieve certain policy goals. A non-instrumental approach to law takes law as a cultural asset. Let's say we were studying antiquity, ancient Greece. So we might look at what Herodotus wrote. We might look at the laws they passed. We might do some archaeology to understand how they lived, how their houses were built. But we will also read Sophocles and Euripides and Aristophanes. And these are works of fiction. They are the tragedies or comedy of the great Greek tragedists. Why would we be looking at those when we want to study ancient Greece? It's not a class in literature, it's a class in the history of Greece. And our answer is obvious, because by reading Sophocles, by reading Aristophanes, we learn something very important about the society. What are the things they admired? What are the things they despised? What are the things that made them laugh? So it's a cultural asset from which we learn. And law is also not just instrumental. It tells us certain things about society, not in an instrumental way, but what are the sensibilities of the society. So a non-instrumental approach to law would look at a decision of a court and say, I'm not so interested in what the outcome of the case is, who won the case, who lost. Can you have a crucifix on the wall? Can you not have a crucifix on the wall? I'm interested to see, for example, how the court framed the question, how it understands religion, which is not directly connected to the decision in the case, but how the court says what it says, how it reaches its decision. We learn things that are not about the law, but are about the sensibility of the society, sensibility of judges, the mores, the values, etc. So that's kind of the approach. I'll give you one more example because it's the direction I go. Let's take a children's book for maybe 2 or 3 year old. So it's a picture book, and you see, I don't know, people playing, children playing in the park or playing with their dogs, etc. So the function of the book is to entertain the children, teach them something. Anya was showing me a book she had, My First Instrument. So you see a harp or a violin, and it says violin, and There's even a little button and you push and you have the sound of the violin. But when you look at that book, you see that the girls are dressed in pink and the boys are dressed in blue. It's not the intention of the book, but it has that indirect genderizing effect that girls are pink and boys are blue. If you looked at it just, you would say, oh, they learn about my instruments. But indirectly, just because accidentally the way the little kids in the book are presented, it already has a genderizing effect. And that's the kind of approach that I'm going to be adopting in my lecture. Now, the first thing I want to talk about values, the values of European integration. And I'm not going to present them in a normative way. This is what I think ought to be the values of European integration. I'm going to present them in an empirical way. What does Europe say its values are? So it's not me doing political theory, it's me doing social science, empirically to find out what the values are. So the first proposition is, you still find in many books that introduce the European Union, the law of the European Union, the following proposition. That the European Union started as an economic project, the European Coal and Steel Community, the European Economic Community, and slowly it transformed into a political project. It's totally wrong. It's just empirically wrong. If you look at the preamble to the Treaty of Paris, establishing the European Coal and Steel Community, it just cuts and pastes out of the Schuman Declaration and says, we are interested in peace. We have to end the 200-year enmity between France and Germany. That's a political objective. And then establishing the European Coal and Steel Community becomes an instrument for realizing a political objective. So first we have to rid ourselves from the notion that it started economically and slowly became politically. It started politically and showed slowly the instruments to realize its political objectives began to change. So now we know that values come as a hierarchy of values. I ask myself, what is the most fundamental values? I ask myself empirically, not again, I'm not being normative, it's not what I think. And the expression of the most abstract, the most, the meta value, the sort of ur, I find in Jean Monnet when he writes, nous ne coalissons pas des états, nous unissons des hommes. We are not about bringing states together. We are trying to bring human beings together. And I think that is, I don't make any judgment of it, but I think that is the most abstract and highest articulation of why Monet starts the process of human integration. He wants to redefine relations between human beings. So it's not about states. And he uses a very powerful word. He says we want to unite human beings, so to bring human beings together. Now, I want to argue or suggest to you that the value discourse of European integration moved in two cycles. I won't go into my methodology, but again, I'm not being normative, I'm being descriptive. The first cycle, there were three primordial, primitive values. The first one was peace. And the second one was prosperity. Because one way of saying politically why it all happened, it's at the end of the Second World War. Can I be vulgar, or that's not possible?
You
may. I may. So what the fuck do we do with Germany? I mean, they started two world wars. They slaughtered millions of people. How do we deal? We tried to deal with them after the First World War and we failed. So how do we solve the German problem? In some way that's... And the second question was, how do we reconstruct Europe after the devastation of this big war? So we have to have a strategy for peace, and we have to have a strategy for prosperity. And the third value in the first cycle was, we can use the label supranationalism, it's not only to redefine the way states relate to each other, but to redefine the concept of nationalism, because nationalism was thought to be one of the driving forces of the catastrophe of the Second World War. I'm going to come back to these in a few minutes, but that is the third cycle, the first cycle of values. Now, after 10, 20, 30 years, in some ways these values were realized. Because you are too young, most of you, but I remember when there was the referendum on the Maastricht Treaty, I watched a debate or a television in France of Helmut Kohl and François Mitterrand meeting to persuade people to vote yes in the French referendum. And it went through by 20,000 votes. It means if 10,000 Frenchmen would vote the other way, it would have failed. And they talked about the necessity to consolidate the historical peace between Germany and France. And anybody below the age of 45 didn't know what they were talking about. Because what enmity are you talking about? The way young Frenchmen and Germans grew up, there was no... It was a success story. And prosperity, in some big measure, thanks to the common market, not only, but in some big measure, when we're in the 60s and 70s, this is the golden period of European prosperity. People were never as prosperous, I'm not saying rich, but as prosperous as they were. And everybody's children had a future which would be more promising than their parents. And supranationalism was achieved. Those of you who study European law, Van Gendt laws, Costa and Nel, it was a... So those values kind of exhausted themselves. So there came a second cycle of values, or values speak. Because interestingly, if you look at the Schuman Declaration, if you look at the Treaty of Paris, if you look at the Treaty of Rome establishing the European Economic Community, you don't find the word democracy, you don't find the word human rights. They are absent. It wasn't in their mind. So the second cycle of value speak was what I say the Holy Trinity. Yeah, I will tell you my methodology. I went, you know, every time the presidency of the Union changes, the head of government goes to give a speech at the European Parliament. It's a kind of celebratory kind of, you know, it's now the Polish presidency. And they always talk about values, you know, it's one of those occasions when they can forget their petty national politics and talk about the great vision of Europe, etc. And that's why I say it's the Holy Trinity. It's always democracy, human rights, rule of law. If you're German, it's rule of law, human rights, democracy. But that's what it is. Those are the three values in the second cycle. So we have six values. In more recent times, I don't know if it would qualify, we are also interested in environmental responsibility. I'm not sure if that's a policy or that becomes a foundational value. It's not so important for what I'm trying to do in my conversation with you today. Okay. So now I want to introduce law. Because how did law capture the value discourse. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. How did law capture it? So, if you're interested, I have a draft paper that I could later send if people want to read the footnotes and all that. But I wouldn't bother. But if you are, if it's available, if you're interested. So I think also European Union law has three big cycles. The first cycle is community rights, like the 60s and 70s. That's the big constitutional revolution. Van Gendel laws. You tell me that I have to pay a custom union duty. I don't, because Article 12 of the treaty says no new custom duties and this, and I can rely on community law to give me a right which I can even oppose against my government. And that's what we spend a lot of our time learning and teaching and practicing when we do community law. Most cases under the preliminary reference procedure, I would estimate like this, 80% involve an individual challenging a public authority in his or her state and saying, the state says you have to do X, but European Union law says I don't have to do X, and I'm using it to vindicate my community rights. It's still the bulk of what we do with European Union. The second, starting in 1969, and I'm sure you are all familiar with the story, it was embarrassing that the Union demanded supremacy of Union law, but did not guarantee that the Union law that would pass did not violate fundamental human rights. So, starting in 1969 with the famous Staude against the city of Rome, and then Internationale Händelgesellschaft and Nold, and you know, the court invented ex nihili, that actually the legal order, although the word human rights is not mentioned, it does protect fundamental human rights. And then the story goes on, and now we have the charter, blah, 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 blah. And that's a second big cycle. And the third one is introducing citizen rights. That begins after the Maastricht Treaty and gets some traction with Nice and Amsterdam, and then full traction with Lisbon. And you all know the case law, Garcia Vela and Grelcic and Zambrano, and that now I'm claiming rights as a citizen of the European Union. What unifies these three big waves, which I think capture in a very serious way the European legal project, is that they are right-oriented. And because they are rights-oriented, they put the individual in the center. It's very peculiar, but again, if you just think about empirically, since there's no private European law, etc., it's amazing how much European law involves an individual vis-a-vis a public authority. I remember Mrs. Merkel once, when she was in the European Parliament, she says, in Europe, we put the individual in the center. And when you think carefully about it, I at least would argue that that's how the law captures the value sphere. Because wars are made by states. If you put the individual in the center, you shy away from it. And prosperity, it's not abstract prosperity. It's individual who become more prosperous. And democracy is about individuals. And human rights is about individuals. So this way the law becomes the law of rights, you will be hard-pressed to find in European Union law individual duties. It's very rights rich, it's very duty thin. For example, we don't pay taxes, which is one of our normal duties as individuals. So, and by putting the individual at the center, the legal structure reflects the value speak that I described before. That's the end of the second chapter. Now, I want to explain to you I think the innovation in my thinking here. What I want to introduce is the notion of virtue and virtue ethics. Now, I don't know, this is a pretty Catholic country, and you know, when I teach anywhere else, I assume that everybody is secular, but yeah, maybe that's a wrong assumption. So, in any other place, I have to explain what virtue ethics means, but maybe here less so, but I will still explain. So, virtue ethics, the origin of virtue ethics, it's not religious, it's Aristotle, but then Aquinas in Christianity and Maimonides in Judaism, they put it at the center of their moral project. And virtue ethics does not ask what is the right action that you take in a certain circumstance. If you've done oral philosophy, you've all seen these examples. There's a train running down, and it can either go to the left or it can go to the right, and if it goes to the left, there are 10 people tied to the railway, so it will kill the 10 people. If it goes to the right, it's your mother. And you standing on the switch, and you have to decide whether I will say the switch to kill my mother or the switch to kill the 10 people. And you spend 3 hours in this absurd situation, which never happens in real life, and the moral philosophy is very sophisticated in answering. That's the kind of normal deontological premise of our culture. It can be utilitarian, it can be other forms of deontology. Virtue ethics asks a different question. Who is the virtuous person? What is the life of a virtuous person? So, I forget it because I'm old and forgetful, but again, if you're interested, there's a wonderful article, How Virtue Ethics Treats the Issue of Abortion. So it doesn't ask the question, is abortion moral or ethical or unethical or in what circumstances? It asks, what would a virtuous person do in the circumstance? So the individual circumstances become very interesting because there can be different answers by virtue ethics. You know, Immanuel Kant says, lying is always, he's the great non-virtue ethics, lying is always wrong. And virtue ethics will say, actually, if you're hiding an innocent person from his persecutors who come to kill him, and they ask you, is he hiding in your cellar? The virtuous person would lie and say, no, no, there's nobody in my cellar. Whereas Immanuel Kant would say that's a wrong act. So virtue ethics has a different take. I want to now explain the relationship between virtue and values, because they are distinct, although they are related. So, honesty. We can say that we believe in the value of honesty. And I'm always assuming good faith. I'm not talking about hypocrites. Remember that. So we believe in the value of honesty. But somebody, he tells lies, not because he doesn't believe in the value of honesty, because he has weak character, because if somebody asks him a question, he's just embarrassed or afraid, and he tells a lie. Did you go to school today? And he went to the cinema. He said, no, I went to school. Now, it's not that he doesn't believe that honesty is. He even feels guilty about it. But his personality, he tells lies. So let's say there's a value of patriotism, you know, having a responsibility towards your country and defending it when it's attacked. So somebody can say honestly, not hypocritically, I'm a patriot, I love my country, I think I want to defend it. But in the battlefield, he will not have the virtue of bravery that will actually enable him to realize the value. I'm giving these examples to explain the difference between a value and a virtue. Now, they're connected because if You need virtues in order to realize the values. If you say we believe in honesty, but nobody actually is honest, it becomes empty to say you believe in honesty. But in most circumstances of life, the tension is different. Somebody can genuinely say, I'm a patriot, I believe in honesty, etc. But not have the virtues necessary to realize that value. Okay? Now, here is where I look at Aristotle and Aquinas and Maimonides, and I follow them in two ways and I don't follow them in a third way. And you have to tell me when we get to the Q&A if you study virtue ethics here, because that would be the first place that students actually study virtue ethics, because mostly it's disappeared. Among the moral philosophers, you can count them on the fingers of one hand, Philippa Foote, a couple of others who do virtue ethics. Everybody else is just abandoned, and I will explain why. So the three of these, Aristotle, Aquinas, and Maimonides, both of whom are influenced by Aristotle, incidentally, they say virtue, first of all, it's a personal trait. It's tremendously important because usually in moral philosophy we're not talking about people. They say that's for psychologists. But they say virtue is a personal trait. It's tremendously important for what I will be saying later, although it seems trivial, but it's not at all trivial. And then they say something even more important. They say it's not a personal trait that you are born with, or at least it's not a fixed personal trait. You can cultivate virtues, or you can corrupt virtues. And that, again, is tremendously important to the thesis I will be presenting to you in 4 or 5 minutes. So I want to illustrate this. Let's say we believe in the value of good family life, respect between husband and wife, and harmony, you know, some kind of ideal family life. And we generally believe that family life is an important value for ourselves, for our society. And then we grow up in a family where the husband beats the wife all the time, where there's violence. And it becomes normalized because the little child sees that every now and then his father gets angry with his mother and he bashes her. So it influences the virtues of the little child because he takes that for normal, and now he understands that it's okay that when I married, he won't even think about it. He will just say, that's how it is. So we will have coarsened, just because of the environment in which he grew, it will affect the way he will treat his wife in the future, etc., because that conditioned his virtue. He won't control his violence because it seemed the normal way to grow. So all of these three great philosophers say you can corrupt virtues or you can cultivate virtues. Cultivate virtues even by practice. If you repeat it and repeat it and repeat it, it becomes part of your personal trait, which is the first proposition. Now, yeah, I have to say to you, you can be convinced or you cannot be convinced, but that is virtue ethics. I hope you are convinced that you realize that values without virtues are going to be empty. If we believe in democracy but nobody takes the trouble to go and vote, it will be an empty democracy because people are lazy and they don't care. So you need a certain civic virtue in order to realize I want to live in a democratic society. Or I need to stand for office, not just expect others to stand for office. I have to serve the public. If people don't have that virtue of, okay, I have to do something, I don't. Now, where I depart from them, and this is the explanation why virtue theory disappeared about 200 years ago from our discourse, it's because Aristotle, Aquinas, Maimonides, and others that followed in their footstep, they purported to tell us what are the virtues. And that becomes, why is it that and not something else? And they just would say, because I say so, because it appeals to you intuitively, etc. So virtue theory, virtue ethics are also very invasive. It's much more easier for me to turn to Michal Matlack and say, do you believe in honesty? And he will say, sure. It's much more invasive if I say to him, are you an honest person? Well, who has always been 100% honest? Virtue ethics makes us judgmental in a much more invasive way, because we say, okay, we know what you believe in, but how do you behave? So, modern society, and I mean in the historical sense, 200 years, etc., shies away from virtue ethics. First of all, who are you to tell me what the virtues are? And B, because you cannot use the categorical imperative of Kant to define virtues. And B, now with the rise of the individual in the neo-Kantian mode, it's not for me to judge you, it's not for me to ask you invasive questions, etc. And it's reached the stage, this is a footnote, that we never talk about virtues, but we've come to believe that our values are virtuous. So I feel a virtuous person because I believe in human rights. Who in this room doesn't believe in human rights? Everybody, right? Makes you feel good. I'm a virtuous person. I believe in human rights. The holding a certain value has come to be seen in our society as a virtue. These virtuous people hold good values in mind. And we are much less concerned if they actually realize those values, and we are much less concerned in cultivating the virtues which will enable us to realize the values. So where do I depart from Maimonides and Aquinas, etc.? I'm not going to decide this is what virtue is. I'm going to have a much more narrow and modest definition. I'm going to say, we've established what the values of European integration are in an empirical way. This is what Europe, how Europe wants to think about its core values. And then I will say, I will define as virtuous those personality traits which help us to realize those values of European integration. You with me? So you see, it's much more modest, it's less contentious. Because the values have been defined empirically, this is what Europe says our values are, and the virtues will be the virtues that either are helpful to realize those values or are unhelpful to realize those values. Are we on the same page? So I gave you already one example. If we believe that Europe should be democratic, then people who are disinterested totally in politics, who on the day of election prefer to go to the STI instead of going to vote, who never stand for public office, etc., they don't have virtues that are necessary to realize democracy. I'm being functionalist here. I'm saying, if you want to have a robust democracy, you need people interested in the polity. So now my thesis. These are the ground rules, this is the methodology. My thesis, and I will illustrate it in two cases, although in my paper I illustrate it for all six values, that the practices of European integration militate against or corrupt the virtues that are necessary to realize the values of European integration. I'll repeat this. That the way we practice European integration, you remember I said if you grow up in a family where the husband beats the wife, the environment shapes your virtues. So, the way we practice European integration, the way European law operates, the way we do it, influences, because virtues can be cultivated or can be corrupted, it corrupts the values that are necessary to realize the very values of European integration. That's my thesis. Whether I will persuade you or not is different, but at least that's my thesis. I've tried to be very, very clear and very, very pedantic and didactic in how. Do you want to ask questions right at this point before I go and illustrate it, or should I just go on? Any clarifying question, something is not clear? So I go on. So I'm going to give you two examples. So first of all, or maybe three, let's see how much time we have. So first of all, we have to go back a little bit to the values we discussed before. So let's take peace, or let's take prosperity. We normally don't think of peace as a value. We think it's a good situation. We have an interest in peace, you know, why should people kill each other, etc. Or prosperity, what, being rich is a value? Usually, when we think about values, it's not just, if I were a rich man, how nice it would be. That's a desideratum, that's a desire. But it's not necessarily a value. Usually, value discourse demands something of us. If we want peace, it has to go against our tendencies to try and achieve things by force or aggressive nature, etc. And that's, if we think deeply about the values of European integration, they are of that nature. I'll illustrate, there's a fundamental difference between the peace after the Second World War that the United Nations put in place, the peace structure, and the peace structure that the European Union put in place. The peace structure of the United Nations is classical. Prohibition on the use of force, a Security Council, a whole apparatus to make states not go to war with each other. Most peace treaties are like this. That's what Europe did after the First World War. They said we have to prevent Germany from going to war, so we will impose on her economic, they would have to pay reparations. If you look at it, it's really laughable. In 1920, they would have to pay reparations until 1990, for 70 years. And in today's money, it would be hundreds and hundreds of billions of dollars in reparation. And they said, if we do that, they will never become economically strong, so they will not be able to threaten us. And then the second condition was you cannot have an army. So if you cannot have an army, you cannot threaten us. It was like taking yesterday's enemy and putting your foot on his neck and saying, I'm going to keep you firmly down so that you don't threaten me again. And of course it backfired. Those conditions were a catalyst for the Second World War because the Germans felt humiliated and Hitler was able to manipulate it and we lost our honor and they treat us as a second state. The peace structure of the European Union or European communities, as they were called once, was very different. It was really a peace of the brave. And it had its roots because all those founding fathers, and I'm afraid there were no mothers at that time, were very committed Catholics, and they speak about it in their memoirs. And it was a peace that did exactly the opposite. We will treat Germany just as an equal. We will not look to the past, we will look to the future. We, instead of putting our foot on their neck, we will embrace them so tightly that the thought of resolving a dispute by going to war, which is what we French and Germans did every generation for 200 years, will be unthinkable. And especially, we will practice this great value of forgiveness. So you did terrible things, but we forgive. We look to the future. You understand, put in these terms, the peace becomes a value because it requires you to overcome your vengeance, your hatred. I will show them, you know, Churchill saying we should strew that land with salt. No, 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 no. That's a very different way. Prosperity also, it wasn't just let's get rich. Because first of all, against abject poverty, prosperity brings dignity. It brings the value of dignity. It's not about being stinking rich, it's about people not being dependent on others. Not having to go and ask for, that's dignity. And secondly, most remarkable about the prosperity project of the European Union was, we're not going to try and get rich at the expense of the other. We will be this common marketplace in which our prosperity will, we will become prosperous together, rather than I will devalue my currency and I will have a trade war with you, etc. There's a certain economic interdependence where we want to progress together towards prosperity. It's a very, very different project for simply, you know, a Marshall Plan, etc. So that's why it comes into the category of value, of ideals, rather than just interest. So now, keep in mind the metapolitical deep value of redefining human relations. Nous ne coalissons pas des états, nous unissons des hommes. We don't bring states together, we want to bring different type of human relation. So, and let's look at how we went about achieving the prosperity, which I now described as an ideal. So the instrument we used was the economic theory of Freiburg, order liberalism, and the instrument of the common market, now we call it the single market. And I want to make three observations about that. Number one, the very idea of the common market is that through competition between individuals, the most efficient will win, and then there will be a spillover effect to the whole economy. But order liberalism says you have to allow people to compete with each other. It depends on that basic human desire to succeed and to become individually more prosperous. And when you let that in the marketplace, then it brings up the economy as a whole. But at the, in the individual level, it's a very competitive instrument. I want to get ahead. It relies on that. Competition is at the heart. The common market rules, which we study in our European law classes, are to make the playing field level so that the most efficient will win. Second, let's look at the legal rules of the common market. So they're always done in the following structure. We have the market rule, free movement of goods. Let's take the most classical. You're all familiar with it, right? So you cannot have obstacles to goods, free movement of goods. You cannot have obstacles and you cannot discriminate. So if a good is produced in Poland, it has to go freely into Germany. The Germans cannot put a tax on it, they cannot put a custom duty on it, they cannot have a discriminatory regulation. Open market. You with me? Now, sometimes you say, but this good is dangerous, it's unsafe, or it's pornography, it's immoral, or something like that. So you have an exception. Right? You remember the old Article 36, notwithstanding the above, anything, public morality, public policy, the health of animals and humans, the list of exception, and then the doctrine in D'Assonville and Cassis de Dijon, etc. We all on the same page? But not what the legal structure does. The default is the market. The value, public policy, public morality, health, etc., is the exception. Now, virtue theory says to us that this way, these ways of thinking shape us. Because we are taught again and again that the supreme value is the market. And if you have other competing values, they become an exception to the real value, which is the open market. And every European Union law teacher in this room has taught his or her students that when you have an exception, you have to interpret it narrowly. So the market you interpret expansively, and the exceptions, the public policy, the public morality, you oblige to interpret narrowly. And then if we look at positive integration, when we pass directives, it's subject to subsidiarity. Let's think a minute about subsidiarity. So they say they borrowed it from Catholic social doctrine. The only thing they borrowed from social Catholic doctrine is the word subsidiarity. Because actually it's the opposite. Because Catholic social doctrine, when subsidiarity was developed in the 20s and 30s, wanted to responsibilize individuals. Don't rely on public authority on the state. Feel that you yourself are responsible. You have to do something. Now, look at any subsidiarity discourse in the context of the European Union, and the question is, which public authority is responsible? Is it the town? Is it the region? Is it the state? Is it the European Union? But the assumption is that the responsibility for public goods is by public authority. How does this condition us? If something doesn't work, the buses don't run, the water is not clean, the schools are shit, sorry again. We always are acculturated by subsidiarity. The only question is, which is the public authority which is responsible? You never point a finger at yourself, because that's what subsidiarity is. It's the assumption of such subsidiarity in the European Union is that public authorities are responsible. As I say, it's the exact opposite of Catholic social doctrine. Now let's take all these things together. So we know what we meant when we said we have to try and achieve prosperity, etc. But look what it does to the individual. In this scheme of the way we practice European integration, first of all, it is premised on a self-interested individual who tries to better his conditions, because that's what drives order liberalism, the common marketplace. It's premised on that, that individuals will try and maximize their personal interest, and if enough people do that, there will be a prosperity spillover. Second, it acculturates us that the open market is the value and the exception are, you know, all those other things which are in the exception clause, which we interpret narrowly. And thirdly, it de-responsabilizes the individual, because on the positive side of integration, it acculturates us that the only debate we should have in our society is which public authority should be responsible. The union, the state, the region, the city. But indirectly, like the boy in blue and the girl in pink, it's the possibility that maybe no public authority should be responsible is not even contemplated in the discourse. So now, if we go back to Merkel and European Union law, it absolutely puts the individual in the center, but slowly but surely turns the individual into a self-centered individual. The individual is in the center, but becomes a self-centered individual. And self-centered individuals are inimical to the meta-value of redefining human relations. Because if we said the meta-political objective of the treaty is to redefine human relation. Nous ne coalisons pas des états, nous unissons des hommes. It's a very defective way to go about this when you acculturate the human beings which are the members of your community to act in A, the self-centered way, and you acculturate them to de-responsibilize themselves and always to shift responsibility to public authorities. Anything that does not work, the only question is which is the public authorities that should be responsible. So that's one example I want to show. It's a totally non-instrumental approach to law because it's not, we're not asking what is the correct interpretation, we're not asking, we just say the way we've structured it, and very successfully, the marketplace has worked. It exactly produced what it was meant to produce, an increase in aggregate prosperity. But I am claiming is that it also produced increasingly self-centered individuals who put their individual interest above everything else. I don't want to be apocalyptic, but I'm sure that there's more than a grain of truth to that statement. And I don't want to say that it's only the European Union, but I say the European Union contributes to that process of atomization, individualization, that characterizes our society. Should I give another example? Because it just will illustrate. I can illustrate to you with human rights very quickly. Because human rights seems almost counterintuitive. How can our great belief in human rights produce this corruption of virtues that you are claiming is happening? So I'll tell you. Actually, it's in my view, it's even simpler. Excuse me a minute. First of all, it's our obsession with rights in generally and human rights in particular. Now, make no mistake. I would not want to live in a country that does not protect fundamental human rights. Okay? So, I'm not an anti-rights person. But why do I say it's excess? Take, I don't know, a citizen of Italy, a citizen of Spain, a citizen of Germany. I don't know about Poland because, so I better keep off the topic. So an individual in Rome, in Italy, his rights, even his human rights, are protected by the Bill of Rights in the Italian Constitution and by the Italian constitutional courts. It's pretty robust. Then, if it's not enough, they are protected by the European Court of Justice and the Charter of Human Rights in as much as anything to do with the European Union is concerned. Then, if that's not enough, they are protected by Strasbourg and the European Convention on Human Rights and the European Court on Human Rights in Strasbourg. This is not rights deficit, this is rights surfeit in a big time way. Okay, so what's so bad about that? Nothing in and of itself, but now if we look what it does to our culture, the unintended, the non-instrumental approach. So first of all, it's what's not there that's interesting. It's all about rights, 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 human rights, community rights, citizens' rights, etc. You will only find the word duty once in the treaties. In the citizenship clause, it says nationals of the member states are citizens of the European Union and will enjoy all the rights and subject to all the duties specified therein, and that's the only time the word duty is mentioned. Take a magnifying glass and find any duty in the treaties that of an individual, other than obeying the law. That doesn't count. So it's rights without duties. We begin with. Second, and this is for me the most classical example of what the tension between values and virtues is. How do we experience violation of human rights? most of us live in societies where we're not going to be thrown into prison without some judicial order and be beaten up, etc. It doesn't happen to people sitting in this room. It might happen to some migrant workers, it might happen, but it's not, most of you will go through your life without your human rights being violated. And if they're violated, you will know very well how to defend yourself and all the legal remedies, etc., etc. So how do we experience? We read it in the morning newspaper, on some Facebook postings, disgraceful. The German police beat up these three refugees, or whatever violation of human rights has taken place. So our reaction is indignation. This is terrible. And it's genuine indignation. We're not hypocrites. We really think this is terrible. And then we say, this cannot be in our society. We're not that kind of society that allows that to happen. And then we say, the government ought to do something about this. And we drink our orange juice and go to work. The fact that we hold important human rights in a genuine way, our indignation is realistic, demands nothing of us. It doesn't demand anything of us except to believe that they are important and to be indignant when they violate. It calls for no action. And in our real life, we make no action. Maybe we will vote for somebody else the next time, that's it. For my view, in a deep sense, this is corrupting. Because it's the same kind of de-responsibilization. All we have to do to be virtuous is to believe in something, but it doesn't demand of us to do anything. And if it doesn't demand for us to do anything, why would we expect that human rights would be protected? It's not, human rights is about human relations. But where's the human relations if all that happens is you and move on and say somebody has to do something about it? Which does not mean we should stop believing in it. But now, note the following, for competition, antitrust, it's the biggest DG in the commission. There are hundreds of lawyers working to ensure that the market behaves in a competitive way. The most prestigious commissioner, apart from the president, is DG Competition. That's the big prize when the member states argue about state aids, etc. There's no commissioner for human rights. There's no DG for human rights. Do you understand that acculturation here? For competition, it's the biggest service of the Commission of the European Union. For human rights, where we have the charter and we believe and we say the Holy Trinity, democracy, rule of law, and human rights, where's the DG? Where's the policy? Where's the money? To make sure that it doesn't just remain something that now and again will get to the court, but will become a reality on the ground. That actually in the life experienced by people in our society who actually suffer human rights, it will not happen. It doesn't exist. There's a message that is being sent there in terms of what are our priorities. If our biggest DG is competition, and there's no DG for human rights, it must have some effect on how we think about it. And the effect it has that we think that what we have to do in human rights is to believe that they're important and to have more and more our Constitutional Court, and then the Charter, and the European Convention on Human Rights, and everybody sitting in this room in this kind of seminar knows that judicial protection is not the way you ensure non-violation of human rights. It takes place in the street. It takes place in the administration. It takes place in prisons. It takes place, that's where the violations take place, for people who never get to the court. If you look at the cases who get to the court, they are not by the people who actually suffer in their daily experience violation of human rights. We put the individual in the center, we make the individual self-centered. And that runs against the values which we hold dear. Thank you.